Hey guys, it's Jennifer. Welcome back to my channel, and welcome back to another installment in my Vikings series. Today, in honor of the fact that the Vikings TV show is coming to an end, it is finally coming to an end. All of the episodes, I believe, are streaming on Amazon Prime, which is really unusual given how they've released in the past. But that happens today on December 30th. I'm really depressed about it. I've had my issues with the last couple of half seasons of Vikings. But for the most part, I still just genuinely love this show. And I have to say, no other piece of media has actually influenced life decisions for me the way that Vikings has, which sounds crazy when I say it aloud that I made actual life decisions based on this television show. But I studied abroad in Copenhagen, Denmark. The only reason that I even looked at the University of Copenhagen is because I knew Ragnar Lothbrok was Danish. And while there, I wrote an academic paper on Ivar the Boneless. I gave a presentation on Ragnar. I saw one of the earliest manuscripts we have of Ragnar's saga and the original iteration of this story. Now, is Vikings historically accurate? No. Is it trying to be? Also, no. So don't go into this show looking for a history lesson, but it's a great jumping off point. That's what it was for me. I fell in love with Ragnar on the show. The Ragnar Lothbrok that we see in Vikings is my favorite fictional character of all time. This is a show that is very personal to me, and it has, of course, gone on to kind of color my own interests as a historian. And so I thought today we would do something really kind of fun and kind of niche, and I am going to recommend books to the characters of Vikings. So I am really only going to recommend books to the overarching main characters. So Ragnar, Lagertha, Floki. I did include Athelstan, interestingly enough, though he hasn't been in it for a very long time. And of course, the sons of Ragnar. So I decided to limit myself on what I could recommend them. So nothing that they actually could have read in universe. So no ancient classic, no kind of religious text from the time period. And I am also not going to recommend anything Viking themed. So no Viking historical fiction, no Viking classics, no sagas, nothing that could even vaguely be considered Norse to make this more of a challenge for me. And it really, really was a challenge. And there are going to be some semi-spoilers here for the past few seasons of Vikings, because some of the characters I'm referring to are, of course, no longer on the show. We are now on kind of the second generation, so several of these characters I talk about are no longer on the show, except in memory, which is definitely the case for the first character that I'm going to talk about, and that's Ragnar. He is essentially where the show began. This show was built on the back of Ragnar Lothbrok, and as I said before, Ragnar is my favorite fictional character of all time. The iteration of him on this show is just so absolutely fantastic. So Ragnar is somebody on this show who really kind of builds his way up. He starts off very, very low socially. He is a farmer when we first meet him, and he has dreams of sailing west. This is not really what happened in the historical record or in the saga. Truly, it's really not. But this iteration of Ragnar started life as a farmer. And he dreamed of sailing west, of seeing kind of these mythical islands that people were talking about, which were England and Ireland. And so the show has him at the sack of Lindisfarne, the first big Viking attack that was recorded in the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, and really is thought to have kind of brought in the Viking Age. And as the show progresses, Ragnar progresses as a character. Ragnar is not a good person. He's not a good man. And he makes a lot of poor decisions. He makes a lot of decisions to punish other characters when they wrong him. But he also has a real heart of gold. There are some things that he won't do. There are some lines he won't cross. And as the seasons go on and as his character develops and he becomes maybe a little bit worse, he becomes a little bit more of a darker character, he gains power. And so he transitions from this kind of farmer, dreamy Viking sailor, somebody who dreams of seeing all of these other lands. he transforms from that into a king, a Norse Jarl into a king. It's a little bit of a sad transition in my opinion, because what is attractive about Ragnar as a character in these early seasons is that he's very, very curious, and he desperately hungers for knowledge. He wants to learn, he wants to travel, he wants to see things. And he's also very concerned with fame, which is a big Viking trait. This was something huge in Norse culture. It's making sure that your name is remembered. And so that kind of plays into his character development. As he becomes more powerful, he becomes a little bit more concerned with his name living on. And so I would like to recommend him a book that's all about being forgotten. And that's The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue by V.E. Schwab. And so this is a book about a girl who makes a deal with the devil to live forever. Her wish is granted, but there is a caveat. She will be forgotten by everyone who meets her. And this is an instantaneous forgetting. Literally, she walks out of your line of sight. You forget about her. You forget the fact that you had a conversation with her. Addie struggles to form relationships with people. You know, maybe to her, she's been with somebody a few months, but to them, they knew her that night and that night only. And so she really fights throughout her 300 years of life. This book spans 300 years from the time that she makes the deal with the devil to the present day, essentially. And she is not going to give in. She is doing everything she can to spite this devil-like creature that she made the deal with, who kind of tricked her. And so what this book is really about is less so about Addie as a person or about the kind of devil figure as a person, but it is more about the concept of how can you be remembered. Addie's fight in this book is to be remembered. And she does eventually meet somebody who remembers her. And so there's something very, very magical about this story, and there's also something very haunting about it. And I think of all of the characters on Vikings, Ragnar is genuinely the most haunting. Ragnar, now that he is gone from the show, his presence has genuinely always been felt in every episode since his last, in my opinion. He's very, very present in all conversations between the sons, conversations about power, about whether or not they are living up to his legacy. And so Ragnar definitely is remembered, but it was something that he feared in his own lifetime, was that he would be forgotten. I think his innate curiosity about things and about places would make this book very compelling to him. And I just think that he would relate in a way to the concepts played with here. How are you remembered? And if you aren't remembered by name, then you're remembered by some kind of deed, some kind of influence on somebody else. So this is definitely the main book I would recommend to Ragnar. But I have many, many others that I would actually love to recommend him. But the main one is The Raven Boys by Maggie Stiefvater. So in a similar way to Addie LaRue, I feel like The Raven Boys is an extremely haunting series, and it's a series that sticks with you for a very, very long time. And I think it would also work well with Ragnar's personality, because Ragnar is a little bit of an insatiable person. He's always learning, he's always wanting to know more and always wanting to go further, go here, go there, and explore. And he's just a really, a genuinely curious person without being judgmental, if that makes sense. And I think The Raven Boys would work for him in a similar way to Addie LaRue, in that this is a very expansive series that is built on mystery, and mystery that is in some ways never going to be solved. There's always more to learn about this world. And so The Raven Boys is, of course, about a group of boys called The Raven Boys who go to a boarding school in Virginia, and they are searching for a dead Welsh king who has somehow wound up in Virginia. And a whole lot more goes on in The Raven Boys as a series than that. In fact, it's a very difficult series to sum up, but I think that Ragnar would really, really love this. Speaking of The Raven Boys, I would also like to recommend it to another character on Vikings, and that's Floki. So Floki is a really kind of mystical figure on the show. He's very much in tune with the gods and very worried about what the gods think of what they're doing. That really informs all of his decision making. He's not going to do anything unless he feels like it is a decision favored by the gods. So I really think he would like the Raven Boys as well, because it does this really interesting thing where it mystically blends a lot of elements. It's a very mystical series. There's something very Arthurian about it. There's a really interesting link between mythology and the modern day. And I think that's something that Floki would really appreciate. There's a lot of prophecy in this and a lot of really weird, unexplainable happenings that I think Floki would really get into. So I would definitely recommend The Raven Boys to Floki. All right, let's do probably the most famous character from the Vikings, and I definitely see why, and that's Lagertha. So Lagertha has been the main female character for the majority of the show, and in fact, for the past few half seasons, I would almost call her the main character. Lagertha is a very strong female character. She has always been a shield maiden, and she started the show as Ragnar's first wife. And so they did eventually divorce when he cheated on her. Yeah, Ragnar made some poor decisions, definitely. But there was always a really strong link between Ragnar and Lagertha. And Lagertha continued to really kind of carry a torch for him and love him, and at least always respect him and always feel as though they were equals, because her storyline definitely has paralleled his. She also has moved from a farmer to a queen. And I think her storyline has been really, really interesting over the years. I have loved all of the characters that she's come into contact with and all of the decisions that she has had to make. She's also had to make some pretty terrible decisions. And I have to say, I think her send-off was genuinely more emotional than Ragnar's. I wish that Ragnar had gotten kind of a whole episode dedicated to him leaving like that in the same way that Lagertha did, because that was a genuinely emotional hour of television for me. So I think she would really appreciate books about strong female characters fighting for their place and their right to be in a man's world. So the first book that I would like to recommend Lagertha is one of my favorites of all time, and that's The Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo by Taylor Jenkins Reid. So this is about a classic Hollywood film star who has finally decided to tell her life story and explain why she had seven husbands and just who was the love of her life. This book plays with some very complex issues, and it's full of heart. I think when you walk out of this book, you really feel as though you know Evelyn Hugo. You want to search for her online and find one of her movies to watch it. You want to look up each of the seven husbands and see if what she said about them is really true. You come away from this book really feeling as though she was a real person, and you feel very, very attached to these characters. And Evelyn Hugo herself is not necessarily a nice person. And her version of events, you get the sense, is maybe not quite what always happened. I think Lagertha would really appreciate somebody that raw, that real on the page. I think she would really relate to Evelyn as a character and see herself in her. So I would definitely recommend The Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo to Lagertha. But I wanted to cheat a bit and recommend another book to Lagertha, and that is Circe by Madeline Miller. And I think she would love Circe for probably the same reason that she would love Evelyn Hugo. And that's because Circe is somebody who has really been done wrong by society. So Circe follows the mythical figure of Circe. She is most famous for being in the Odyssey. She is a goddess, and she is sometimes discussed as being the first witch. So she has been ostracized in her society. She's put on an island to be by herself, and she comes into contact with a lot of really famous figures from Greek myth. And I think that Lagertha would just really appreciate Circe's strength. I think she would also appreciate the parts where Circe turns men into pigs. That's what Circe is most famous for in myth, but I think that Lagertha would definitely appreciate that. Speaking of Circe, I would also like to recommend this book to Ragnar's second wife, Aslaug. And so Aslaug is a character who on the show was always a little bit maligned, and I found it a bit unfairly. She was not a warrior, so I have to say I really appreciated seeing that. And I found her to be a very complex figure. though she was often villainized in the narrative, again, unfairly, in my opinion. But she was often termed a witch, particularly by Lagertha. Lagertha always thought that she bewitched Ragnar into leaving her. And so that's kind of always the accusation that was leveled against Aslaug. And so I think that she would relate to Cersei, because Cersei is often ostracized from her own community of Greek gods in this book. She spends, you know, the majority of her life alone on an island. And I think Aslaug would relate to that, because even though Aslaug was always in society and was often actually ruling Kattegat, where they live, she was definitely on her own. She was definitely criticized and hurt by other women on the show, by her husband, by other men, but she also definitely had the gift of foresight. And so I think she would relate to Cersei in many, many ways. So that's definitely the book that I would recommend to Aslaug. The last from the kind of old generation that I wanted to recommend something to is Athelstan. And so Athelstan is a character who was a Saxon monk, and he was taken by Ragnar in that first raid at Lindisfarne because he could speak their language. And he very much changed as a person. He started out life there as a slave, but Ragnar really took to him. Ragnar was very curious about Christianity. And Athelstan became increasingly curious about the Old Norse religion, about the gods, and he eventually became a Viking warrior, and he converted to their religion and then felt absolutely terribly about that and converted back to Christianity. I was really irritated with Athelstan the majority of the time that he was on the show, because I can't take people fiddling back and forth like that. But I do respect it. I respect questioning, and I think that's what made him such a compelling character to Ragnar specifically. So I am going to recommend him something that also deals with the intersection of mythology and Christianity. And that is, of course, Dante's Divine Comedy. You knew I was going to recommend it. Dante is dealing more with kind of Roman and Greek myth intersecting with Christianity than with Norse. But I think the sentiment holds true here, because Athelstan was somebody who struggled with religion and struggled with kind of the intersection between Norse religion and Christianity, and whether or not you should believe only one, you should mix the two. And I think that he would really appreciate what Dante was doing here, which was placing figures from Greek and Roman myth in a Christian afterlife. And so discussing them as if they were figures that actually existed. And I think that Athelstan would really take to that. I think he would find this to be a fascinating work, particularly from his background as a monk. So he would definitely get all of the references that Dante is making, probably both in terms of mythology and in terms of Christianity. So I just think he would really appreciate this. So I would definitely recommend The Divine Comedy to Athelstan. So now we are on to the Sons. And the Sons of Ragnar have become some of my favorite characters of all time. Ivar the Boneless in particular is very close to my heart, because I've spent a lot of time with him in a saga context, in an academic context, and I've also now spent quite a bit of time with him on the show. So I think I'll save him for last. So why don't we kind of go down in terms of age? So we'll start with Bjorn. So Bjorn Ironside is the son who has been around the longest. He actually was a character on the first season of the show, and in fact is probably the only character from the first season of the show to still be around. Bjorn was a really difficult one for me because he is so incredibly stern and stoic, and he is very much a Viking. Of all of the characters on the show, I think there was a lot of nuance, and Ragnar in particular, I think there's a lot of nuance to the other sons. Bjorn is very much the iconic Viking. He is honestly exactly what you think of when you think of what a Viking looks like, when you think of how a Viking acts, or when you think of a berserker, actually. And so Bjorn, I don't picture as being the type of person who would ever want to read a book. But I've decided to recommend him a couple of things anyway. The first thing that I would like to recommend him is Henry V by Shakespeare. This is one of Shakespeare's history plays, and it focuses on maybe the most famous warrior king of England, which is Henry V, who won at the Battle of Agincourt, most famously. So much of this play surrounds Agincourt, surrounds the French campaign in the Hundred Years' War. And I think that Bjorn would really take to that storyline, and he would really enjoy all the kind of discussions of political machinations and battle planning strategy. I think he would really get on with that. And if he decides that he actually is a reader, I think he would also really appreciate Shakespeare's language and the turns of phrase that he uses. But I would also like to recommend him something that's maybe a little bit deeper and a little bit more philosophical than what he would go for at all. And that's The Last Man by Mary Shelley. So The Last Man by Mary Shelley is about a character who eventually becomes the last man on earth when humanity is wiped out by a plague far in the future. This was a very personal book to Mary Shelley as an author, because Mary Shelley had just lost quite a few people, a lot of friends, a lot of family. And so she wrote this as kind of a therapeutic thing, as I understand it. But she definitely felt like she was the last man standing of her group of friends, of her social circle, of her family. And I think, sadly enough, Bjorn is the last man standing in terms of being the only character from the first season to still be on the show, in terms of being one of the few characters that are there now who really remembers how great things were in the first couple of seasons, who remembers Lagertha and Ragnar being together, who remembers Rollo, who remembers those early raids, who remembers who Athelstan even was. And I think that's really sad. I don't think Bjorn really deals with that on the show up front, but I think that that's something that he definitely feels. He is one of the sons who I think feels less of the pressure of Ragnar on him and more of the pressure of his mother. His mother was Lagertha, and the other son's mother was Aslaug. And so I think as time went on, Bjorn felt more of a kinship with his mother than he did with Ragnar. And so I think now, after losing her and having lost him, he is definitely the last of the first generation of the show. And I think that's very sad, and I think he would probably, you know, get a lot out of this book and reading it and kind of processing all of the things that have happened to him over the years. He's definitely a character who doesn't really discuss his emotions up front, but I think that he could read this and really come to terms with them in private. Next is one of my favorite sons, and that's Ubba. So Ubba is the oldest child of Ragnar and Aslaug, while Bjorn was the oldest child of Ragnar and Lagertha, and their only living child, as a matter of fact. And I love Ubba. Ubba is the son on the show to me that bears the most resemblance to Ragnar, not just in terms of looks, but he definitely has kind of a similar heart. I think all of the sons got a little bit of Ragnar's characterization, but Ubba is one of the few who got Ragnar's charm. And so I really, really like Ubba because for the most part, he has seemed like a genuinely noble person. And in fact, noble is kind of the trait that I decided to go with in terms of his recommendations today, because Ubba is definitely a Viking and he's definitely a fighter, but there are some lines he won't cross. And I remember specifically, this was my favorite moment in the show. Honestly, it is when they sacked York. They went into the cathedral there at York and were really just burning and looting everything, and Ubba was so utterly disgusted with it. And I remember that he mercy killed a nun, and I thought to myself, I said, that is just something that Ragnar would have done. And I was finally okay with the show, you know, moving beyond Ragnar and the sons taking over, because I felt like Ragnar was very, very present in Ubba. Ubba has gone downhill for me in the past half season. He got on my very last nerve last year, but I still really appreciate his characterization. I appreciate who he is as a character, because I just really am always attracted to somebody who really struggles with their morality, and I think that Ubba does that. And so I wanted to recommend him La Morte d'Arthur by Thomas Malory. This is one of the classics, perhaps the most famous classic, that deals with the Arthurian legend and kind of knits all of the various Arthurian legends together. And this was written in the 1400s. I believe the idea of knights and kind of chivalric tradition would be genuinely attractive to Uba. I think Uba would understand that. I think that he would fit in that tradition. He definitely feels like an older version of a character. He honestly feels to me like a saga stereotype in a way that some of the other characters on Vikings do not. There are a lot of really grand sweeping stories in Lamort d'Arthur, a lot of kind of machinations, plotting, betrayal that I think that Uba would relate to, because he definitely has a lot of problems with his brothers. He really, really does. They're always fighting with each other. And so I think that he would appreciate a lot of the themes that are present in Lamort d'Arthur. I think he would just really enjoy the Arthurian legend. I also want to recommend to him Red Rising by Pierce Brown. This book is very warlike. It's very packed with fighting. Bjorn might also like it because of that. But there is a real heart to Red Rising that is not present in this first book, but is definitely there in the second and third, that I think give this kind of dystopian sci-fi series just a real genuine sense of purpose. It really does give the series more of a grand scale, and it also makes the books stick with you in a way that I don't think they would otherwise. There are scenes in the third book in particular that are extremely moving, and I think they are moving because of who the characters are, because the characters have developed and changed, and no character in this series is black or white, is good or bad. Well, there are a few that are just straight up bad. But there is a lot of nuance here that I think Uba would appreciate. The struggle between right and wrong, making these really horrible, awful decisions that will cost lives. Fighting with people who you viewed as your friends, who you viewed as your family, definitely Uba would find that relatable. And I think he would really appreciate the heart in this series. As the years have gone on, Uba has lost a little bit of his kind of softness, his kind of nobility, which I hate to see. But I think deep down, he still has a lot of those qualities. And I think those qualities shine through in the subtext of Red Rising. And so I think that he would really get on with that. I think he would really appreciate it. Next we have Vitserk, who I also really like. Vitserk is almost always seen eating something. He has beautiful hair. His hair is always beautifully braided, oh my gosh. But he is a little bit of a middling character, and it always seems as though they don't really know what they want to do with him. And so I've resented what they've done with him over the past couple of years, especially this past half season. What did they do? Why did they do it? I still don't know. I really like Vitserk, and so I would like to recommend him one of my favorite series of all time, and that's City of Brass. City of Brass is about a character who is a little bit of a charlatan living on the streets in Cairo, and when one of her cons goes badly awry, she summons an ancient djinn warrior who then spirits her away to the city of the djinn, and there is a lot of political machinations going on. There's a lot of character development. This is a very character-focused fantasy series, and I would recommend it to Vitserk because I think he would really click with the character of Dara. And so Dara is the djinn warrior that was accidentally summoned. And in the past, Dara has done a lot of bad things. As a djinn, or as a genie, you might say, he has of course been bound to masters over the centuries. And those masters have almost always wanted power, wanted money. And how do you get power and money? Of course, by killing. And so Dara has killed quite a few people. He has been present at a lot of massacres. And so he is a character who has become maligned in the city of the djinn. And I think he really struggles with that. And Vitserk similarly has gone through a bit of an arc like that. He has become somebody who's lost, who doesn't feel as though he has a lot of purpose. And he's also become somebody who's been maligned by other characters for certain actions that he's taken, understandably, in my opinion. But Dara is really lost, and he's not always sure where he belongs. He's not always sure of his purpose. And so I think that is something that Vitserk would really, really understand. So I think Vitserk would really enjoy the City of Brass. Last but not least, let's talk about my ultimate favorite of Ragnar's sons, who is Ivar the Boneless. On this show, he has been genuinely one of the most memorable characters to me, and he makes even seriously questionable storylines, very engaging. I really, really adore Ivar. On the show, he is portrayed as being the youngest son of Ragnar and Aslaug, and he was born essentially without use of his legs, so that's how he got the nickname Boneless. So he's been quite maligned by everybody. He's been looked down upon because he can't walk. And so this has allowed him to really sit and watch people and to become incredibly clever. And so Ivar is really the brains of this show. He is so, so smart. Everything he comes up with, I'm genuinely amazed by. And so he is often kind of the planner. He is the strategist. He is somebody who is thinking 10 steps ahead. And I think of every character I have talked about today, he is the reader. He would definitely read something. If only to know more about his enemies, he would definitely read some of their literature. I think he would do it. And so I wanted to recommend Ivar 10 books. I wanted to do an entire video just recommending books to Ivar. And I thought about going in a very obvious direction. I could recommend The Prince by Machiavelli. I could recommend anything by Machiavelli. I think he would get on with kind of political treatises. I really did consider going with The Prince, but that felt extremely obvious as he himself has paraphrased quotes from The Prince in the show. So I decided to go with a couple of my current reads that I think he would really, really enjoy. So the first of these is The Brothers Karamazov by Fyodor Dostoevsky. And so this is a Russian classic that is dealing with a really fraught family relationship and the relationship between multiple sons and a horrible father. Now on the show, Ragnar was not a great father, but he was also not horrible. And so, in fact, since he has been gone, his memory has gone up for the sons, I think. But he did leave Ivar as a baby on the snow, intending to leave him out to exposure because of his disability. And so Ivar always resented that. But Ragnar also really respected Ivar's mind and took Ivar with him on his last raid. So there's definitely a really interesting relationship between Ivar and Ragnar, because you definitely get the sense that Ivar is really his true heir on the show and is always portrayed as such. But Ivar wants to be greater than Ragnar. He wants to be remembered. He wants to be more famous than Ragnar. And in the historical record, he definitely has become more famous than Ragnar. But I think he would really appreciate The Brothers Karamazov because he would really enjoy seeing the fraught relationship between the brothers, because that is something that now very much colors Ivar's life on the show, is the relationship between himself and his brothers, the kind of power struggle. They're constantly fighting each other. He has killed at least one of his brothers. He's seriously wounded another. And so I think he would just really appreciate the family dynamics at play here. It's also a very philosophical and character-driven novel. And so even though there's not a lot of action in it, which I think Ivar would appreciate from a strategist's point of view, I think he will appreciate this in terms of its intelligence and its wit. And so I think he will really like the wordplay here, how Fyodor Dostoevsky describes each of these individual characters, how he sets up character interactions like pieces of chess. I just think Ivar would really get on with this. Another of my current reads that I would recommend to Ivar is Napoleon the Great by Andrew Roberts. And this is a biography of Napoleon. And I think that Ivar would love this just because he also views himself as a real great, as a real military leader, as somebody to be remembered. And he started out always with that intention, knowing that he was going to achieve greatness, that he was going to be the real heir to Ragnar. And Napoleon starts out his career a bit like that as well, knowing that he is going to achieve greatness, knowing that he is going to come into control of France. So there's a lot of interesting background here in terms of the military maneuvers that Napoleon was able to pull off that I think Ivar would find fascinating. And I think that he would also genuinely like Napoleon as a person, because Napoleon was not just a military genius, he was also incredibly smart in a bookish sense. And so I think Ivar would see himself in Napoleon in good and bad ways. Those are the books that I would recommend to the characters on Vikings. And if you would recommend them anything, I would love to hear about that down below. If you've been watching the show and you're sad to see it end, I would love to hear about that down below too, because I'm very depressed about it. But that's going to be all for me today. I hope you're all having a great week. Happy reading. Goodbye.